Okay, hello everybody. My name is Tony Giannini. I'm a professor at the University of Adelaide in South Australia and director of architectural studio Tectus in Adelaide and Melbourne, Australia. Thank you to Federico and Martina for the invite to present to the Politecnico di Mantova. Really a second home in recent years with the undertaking of the TAP workshop programs and also my participation in Mantova Architettura. So it's a pleasure to be invited and to actually talk a little bit about what we've been doing in recent times. I thought I'd just take the opportunity to sort of review the notion of our TAP workshops, which will formulate the basis of this lecture, or really a talk in many regards. This lecture has been built upon an exhibition that was being prepared by the University of Adelaide for the European Cultural Centre 2020 Time, Space, Existence exhibition, an endorsed adjunct programme of the 2020 Venice Biennale this year, which has since been postponed. My understanding is that will be taking place next May in 2021. So due to the current pandemic, travel logistics and the withdrawal of the participation of the Australian Pavilion this year at the Biennale, it was not possible to deliver this exhibition. So why waste the background of what we'd already undertaken? The exhibition would have brought together the collaborative work undertaken by students of the University of Adelaide, Australia, Tongji University, Shanghai, China, and the Politecnico di Milano, Mantova campus. Over a rotating six-year design workshop program, which we've undertaken between 2014 and 2019. Interestingly, we probably would have been in Shanghai for the next round this year, but as circumstances prevail, that is not going to be possible. So beginning as a discussion at the University of Adelaide, to better connect our students at international level, and co-joined after visits to Tongji University and the Politecnico, the workshops have centred on the effect of cultural regionalism in the readaptation and reactivation of buildings and urban realms under the rapid effects of the urbanisation in our cities. The first workshops between 2014 and 2016 really did fuel some emotional response to the end product of the studio work. In Shanghai, the fine grain of the Liulong housing opened our eyes to the destruction of traditional Chinese communities. We felt the pride and the happiness of the Liulong residents amongst the overshadowing of its tall, so-called progressive neighbours, and the sense of community that these families hang on to. I think it's also appropriate this time to acknowledge the mesmerising music that forms part of this presentation. It was composed and performing by Armon, a workshop student from the Milan Politecnico. And we sort of found him in the campus one day with a big grand white piano, just reflecting on the emotional response to the hardships faced by the residents of Liulong. What a beautiful piece of music. So thank you, Armon, for providing that. And as a backdrop, the focus of what you also see in this is really in terms of the backdrop of the workshops and just snapshots in terms of how we've progressed. In Mantova, we had one of the most emotionally provoking site visits undertaken in the old ammunition depot on the Mantova waterfront in Gradaro. In the stillness of the silence of the site visit, knowing that we were walking over the remnants of a Jewish cemetery, truly an inspirational workshop that was put together. Adelaide was very different in revisiting buildings of the Adelaide Jail. I mean, designed to restrict personal freedom and the emotional impact of colonial penal traditions that resonated strongly through the whole workshop design process, as did the spiritual mystery that these buildings sort of whispered and harboured. So the second round of the workshops between 2017 and 2019 delved further and deeper into the fabric of the cities. In Shanghai, we immersed ourselves into the streets of the French Concession area, the leafy, beautiful sort of streets, which have sort of installed as part of the colonial sort of occupation of Shanghai. The design outcomes of the art installation as part of the project were ended up using as prototypes for elements of an exhibition in the Shanghai Planning and Exhibition Center later that year. And I think it's a fantastic reward for the students and also the credibility of those workshops that they could be actually translated into real life installations. In Mantua, the urban form of the Italian civic pride, the piazza, was examined and its repurposing into a relevant era, establishing new cultural links. Second time round in Adelaide, we, as both the youngest city historically and culturally, informed by a melting pot of multiculturalism and diaspora, we looked at repurposing the laneways of the east end of our city under the umbrella of the importance of the viticulture industry of South Australia. Of great validity has been the patronage of these workshops by Federico Bucci under the program of the UNESCO Chair in Architectural Preservation and Planning in World Heritage Cities based in the Mantua campus of the Polytechnic. The exhibition was to be framed around the following narrative. Time reflects the people that participated at that particular point in their life. Space was the city of the workshop, the streets, the piazza, the waterfront. Existence was its cultural diversification, its culture, lifestyle, architecture, art, food, and celebration over three different cultures, three different continents, and three universities. And so the backdrop in terms of the images that you're seeing accompanying this was just a reflection of the three different sectors that were going to be presented, put together as an overview of the fantastic 6-year rotating experience that we've had on these workshops. As a sub-narrative of the workshop, we offered students a thought-provoking way of looking at the regionalism versus globalism debate, with the hope that as the future of the profession, they may advocate for a collaborative ethos into their work. Disrespecting the cultural resolve of our diverse regions as opposed to the rollout of the international curtain wall on all projects, as has become synonymous with the development of our cities. The exhibition was also to present the findings of a 6-year vertical research project by Professor George Zelanty, examining educational sustainability and exploring a more subtle aspect to the traditional meaning of sustainability that involves culture, customs, and industry.
I have a cold, so this might we'll see how this goes. This might end a little bit bad, but we'll see how we go this morning.
When one considers education from an architectural perspective, this aspect of sustainability can be an overriding factor that often determines the success or failure of projects. In particular, to those that work across national borders and international borders and involve different cultures of not only society, but also the industry grouping itself and the way that the people were educated. The results suggest that the social and educational culture plays a role that is just as important of sustainability as that of the construction culture of that country. And as to define a point in time in which we find ourselves, almost this pause moment of education across the world, and the expedited and hurried transition to the virtual and online learning, it could not be more relevant in regard to how we reshape university education globally, in particular to the sharing of information, research and workshops after and during this pandemic. Certainly, the studio experience will change not only in education, but also in the way our studios practice. Another subset of this exhibition was to be our studio's resolve in examining the workshop's culturally diverse educational concept and its relation and impact of the diaspora on our studio's practice. My lecture at Mantova Arquitectura in 2016 looked at the linkages and influence of the seeds of diaspora into our studio, that of being the sons of immigrant Italians to Australia in the early 1960s. It opened with a quote from Celine's Journey to the End of the Night. To travel is very useful. It makes the imagination work. The rest is just illusion and pain. Our journey is entirely imaginary, which is its strength. In trying to understand the underlying ethos of our studio, we often stray to a desire that reflects on the notions of diaspora, the dispersion or spread of people from their original homeland. One that often leads to confusion, struggle, and a conflict of attitudes to a new way of life in an adopted country. The romance of striving to hold on to past values and traditions are an inbuilt influence that contribute into the everyday of life and work. In turn, that emotional element of conflict in a life reflected between multiple cultures also gives opportunity to understand, share, and fuse cultural heritage in a diverse world seeking to distinguish itself between global and loci. In many respects, the TAP workshop program that we founded and foster connects cultures in design to be respectful of each other's region and respond to the loci rather than import their global preconceptions. An ideology that we have always tried to espouse in our work is the respect and recognition of striving to understand our regional identity. Perhaps an Italian attitude that translates back to the parochial Baiese mentality passed on from our parents through storytelling and its influence on our memories.
So it's actually made by our action team, animation team, 3 months, and it's they have like nearly 100 people, like some small people here are playing Taiji, and here there is a small flag over here, and the Chinese pronunciation is 世博斯. And it means the customs in that time, so it's about the...
My experience of the TAP workshop have exposed how the emotional elements of struggle, trace, fusion, and eventually memory influence an approach to design, not apparent in many monocultural identities, and its effect on an attitude to the design outcome over the years. Now for a bit of storytelling and personal thoughts. Over the years in our studio, we've had the privilege to work with many diverse cultures, amongst others, Chinese, Hindus, and Buddhists, and to translate their needs of their diaspora. The notion always remains the same: respect and celebrate their culture and aesthetics. Don't try to convert them to the global manifestation of design. You will find the experience of transcendental design a lot more rewarding and enriching to your value system. And that is why I think we're entrusted and work easily with other cultures. We always strive to understand their traditional value and ethics, and we work with them without prejudice to a style that is often not recognised or glorified by the fashionista architects. Some years ago, we ventured into seeking design work in China. What evolved out of that experience was reverse commissions. Rather than exposing their work or espousing their work to us in their homeland, they were more comfortable with us doing their work in Australia, based on our respect for and understanding their culture. Rather than instilling a predetermined Australian aesthetic, we were entrusted to resolve the importance of holding on to some of their homeland memories in our design conceptualizations. To leave some traces and translate a little bit of home into their projects is of great value. It may not be a pure regionalism, but fusion is an important part of our design attitude in the translated culture and instilling the notion of memory on design in a multicultural country. To phrase Nelson Mandela, if you talk to a man in a language he understands, that goes to his head. If you talk to him in his language, that goes to his heart. As much as we have learnt from our cultural background and adopted country, we have also learnt much from discussions with other cultures and their attitudes to the beauty of life, one that often spawns from a much simpler and pragmatic approach to house shelter. And I offer the following thought. Buildings may capture emotion, but the soul must be happy and willing to accept that emotion. It's not enforceable, as some of the great modernists have found. I was asked a few years ago to talk to the Chinese Academy of Fine Arts in Beijing on the influence of the internet on design. A constant struggle of overexposure and self-grandeur in today's globalized world. Even a time-honored institution such as this, so ingrained in ancient cultural philosophy to the humble way they have seen the world, is today grappling with the me emotion of the next generation and how it should form part of training designers. Their resolve in fusing old and new has been embraced with a passion that still holds on to, firstly, the belief of the idea, and secondly, that of capturing emotional well-being as being the non-negotiable aspect of design. The things that we are left with as designers once technology absorbs all other aspects of the design process. Perhaps as a way of fusing and learning off each other in a highly connected world introduces the seed of a new diaspora, the migration of technological diaspora. We are often asked about our architecture, our style, our philosophy, and our attitude to design. I believe that we are in a privileged position as a profession to have the opportunity to design spaces for people. Every space and building has a heart and soul which invokes sensory perceptions that contribute to the fabric of a place. If our work can capture an emotional response to its user, If it offers them some delight, touches their senses, and invokes their spirit, then I'm happy. In the end, our built forms and spatial creations are a backdrop to people's way of life and beliefs. They should not dictate them. We don't focus on a predetermined approach or language to our work. Like life and the everyday, there is no formula, just involvement and displacement over the years to attitudes, beliefs that come with maturity and response. A new project always excites in its inception. A strong link between sensory, perception, time, place, and emotion, and the vision to encapsulate a space defines the beginning of the design process. Or is it just maybe how we feel on the day? Sometimes as we move into the realms of adjunct academia, as we have, the notions of research into design can become too abstract and meaningless in a search for some higher notion of experience and living. I often reflect on all the theories and PhD dissertations of trying to theorize design. Many subscribe to some philosophical rationalism of some imaginary sensory perception that will have no relevance or contribution to our lifestyle or well-being. To me, design is much simpler than that. Its origins are reflective of who we are, where we have come from, and the way we live. It's a simpler way to resolve design as an emotional and sublime response rather than to, perhaps just theorizing it.
Non eccessiva e viene grattato, messo sempre all'interno dell'impasto. Ultimo ingrediente è l'amaretto sbriciolato, che è un biscotto fatto con delle mandorle e dà un tono amarognolo al ripieno. Anche questo è un ingrediente che contraddistingue il ripieno tipico del tortello mantovano.
Abstract. Whilst I strongly acknowledge that research is essential in terms of advancing knowledge, the basics of providing shelter for anthropology, which is the domain of architecture, whether it be spiritual, habitual, or purely functional, I hope will and still remain in the understanding of the most simplistic basis of humanity, that of well-being and having a good life, the primary ethos of our work, and how relevant is this at this point of time. I touched at the beginning of this talk on the conflict of diaspora, that of being torn between cultures, sometimes the emotion or feeling of being on the wrong side, food, language, aesthetic, and the road to acceptance in a monoculture. The experience of the TAP workshops and the personal experience of our backgrounds have demonstrated that the elements of initial conflict and struggle in the underlying resilience of cultural diaspora are often the ones that in time end up being highly valued in a translated and diffused culture. Many years on by the next generation, and wouldn't it be fantastic to receive some feedback from all the students who've participated in these workshops as to how it has affected their outlook to the way they work.
But in many cases, there are reflections of the light. Here is the one of this moon temple that we saw before, and also, as you can see, the different kind of wood. Now we are entering in the small courtyard, and here you can see the old cathedral, the new cathedral, the old temple of the building. You can see the columns of the little square, the courtyard of the palace. Here we are entering in the temple.
Does the impact on our architecture, or more precisely the aesthetic of architecture? The architecture of Lykai identifies who we are, where we come from, and where we have been. The maturity of a culture is only reflected when there is no boundary between the acceptance of others' aesthetics. The fight and continuing struggle for commanding respect as a local practice in a globalised world has been, till now, an issue confronting the future of the design industry, although I feel that a return to the local is going to be realised as we come out of this current crisis. Thank you.